plentiful. Will streams of abundance flow? Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. When I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name.
Blessed be. I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Life, you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. Close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God.
Thank you. was a wretch. I remember who I was. I was lost, I was blind, I was running out of time. Sin separated, the breach was far too wide. But from the far side of the chasm, you held me in your sight. So you made a way across the great divide. Left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross, you paid the debt I owe. Broke my chains, freed my soul. For the first time I had hope. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life. Brought me from the darkness into glorious light. Took my place, laid inside my tomb of sin. You were buried for 3 days, but then you walked right out again. And now death has no sting, and life has no end. For I have been transformed by the blood.
Glory to Thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Stretched arm, his love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise.
I'll sing as you leave, all right? Down at the cross. Glory to his name. Let's sing together now. Down at the cross where my Savior died. Down where for cleansing from sin I cried. There to my heart was the blood of
of me. Take your prayer lists out if you would, please. Let's go over those. Brother Lee is next door. He'll be handling the prayer time next door, and Austin will be teaching over there. And I said, well, just let me handle the prayer time in here, and I'll preach.
We'll just make this work together. Taking out your prayer list, I trust, as we go through this tonight.
I'll highlight a number of folks on here if we can. We continue to pray for all of the folks on the under senior care needs, and a lot of those folks, and it's just really a special time in their lives, and we just need to lift them in prayer. Health issues, you can see all of those, Carolyn Tidmore, Jim Clements, name after name on there that we continue to pray for, and just a lot of different illnesses. Claire is doing really well. She's on the trip to Branson, remarkably, it's amazing. I tried to talk her out of it, but she went anyway. Becky Shyrock, we will pray for Becky if you would, please. She is really having a debilitating time with her back. And so far, they've not been able to get any answers on Becky. So I know that she would appreciate that. Pete was here. He's in men's Bible study next door. Donna McDonald works next door here. And I mentioned last week, they've got a lot of things going on next door at the dentist's office. So please pray for them. They've got Donna diagnosed with colon cancer. Ashley, one of the ladies that works over there, Ashley is already fighting breast cancer, going through chemo right now. One of the other ladies over there, Stephanie, they are testing her for cancer of the blood right now. Kayla Scott, Dr. Scott, is having some tests run right now, waiting on results, possible cancer as well, or Crohn's or something along that line. So there's just a lot going on over there. So please pray for the dentist's office next door. They're just really special people. But Donna is on that list. We continue to pray for her. Ms. Holtzman, Effie Holtzman, we mentioned to you recently that her daughter who lives with her has COVID. I spoke with Ms. Effie Monday, talked to her on the phone, and she also has COVID now. She was really hoping that she would not get COVID, but she did. And so we need to be praying for her, if you would. She was feeling okay when I spoke to her on Monday. Mary Morgan, still having severe neck pain, is scheduled to go see a doctor soon, and just really desperately needs our prayers. She's just been so ill for a long time, just not feeling well. Carolyn Latour was taken to the hospital for an infection in her colon. She should be going home. Did anybody have an answer on that? Don't know. Lee tried to reach out to them this afternoon to try to find out, and we didn't get an answer. So she was supposed to be going home, but we don't know. She is doing better. We do know that. So under the folks who are in rehab and things, Billy Cannenberg continues to recover from her hip replacement, and she is in Pavilion Rehab there in Grand Prairie. Pray for her. She recovers. Kathy Knuckles has been moved to rehab there at MCA. She's up on the fifth floor in there and hopes to be going home very, very soon. So you remember her in prayer, if you would, please. Recovering at home, you can see there's just a really long list. I will tell you, I talked to Dale Stockberger today on the phone, and Debbie is back at work after her knee surgery. That's a really encouraging thing. So we praise the Lord for that. Sheila Nelson still continues to battle her illness. She was here on Sunday morning, but just really going through a tough time. Good to see Ms. Rayleigh again in the service tonight, and talked to her on the phone Monday, and she just said, "I'm just making good progress," and we praise the Lord for that. And so we're honored that she's able to be here. Melanie Patterson she's home now, but still dealing with the recovery after her surgery, had a high fever and things of that nature. So remember her. Sarah Haynes, rehab facility at Arlington Memorial on the sixth floor, and still recovering. And of course, she is dealing with a cancer issue as well. So you remember her in prayer, she and Norman. And then Glenna Stevens had to go to ER with high blood pressure. I told Jim it's his fault, he's just too good looking. And Brother Stevens told me every time she looks at me, her blood pressure goes up. So I said, "Well, she just has to live with it, brother. Bless your heart." So, but he said she's doing much better. So thank you for that. Alan Lacey, talked to him on the phone today. Been battling pneumonia, and he's still trying to get well, and just having a really rough time. So remember him in prayer, if you would, please. Under special request, certainly continue to pray for Israel. As you know, we've got a group up in Branson right now. Last night, Susan and I were there with them last night. We went to Sight and Sound Theater and saw Esther. And of course, they just simply make the book of Esther come alive. And Susan and I were talking about it as we were driving back today. I said, you know, isn't it interesting for them? Because obviously the whole point of the book of Esther, without mentioning God, is all about God's providence and God's blessing and God's presence. But it was interesting how they were making a point of it, rightfully so, of Haman's hatred for the Jewish people. And you obviously get that message throughout the entire presentation. And I thought about that and the coincidence of, if you will, of where we are in our world today and all the anti-Semitism and the hatred for the Jewish people. You know, here's the thing. Nothing has changed. And the good news about that, I'm not supposed to be preaching yet. This is prayer time. The good news about that is that although the hatred for the Jews still exists, the providence and the presence of God still exists too. Amen. And he's still in control. And so with what's going on in the world today, I want to pray for, of course, the nation of Israel. Doug Atkinson has a very important unspoken request he asked that you remember. So please do that if you would, please, under special requests. Under pastor missionary requests, John, and they're still working, and Issa's still working on getting their home taken care of. And then, of course, we still pray for Issa's mom and situation there in Brazil. Dana McCutcheon, Mark and Dana are here tonight, somewhere right back there. Dana's had a procedure on Monday that did not go the way we had hoped that it would. And so they are asking for wisdom for the doctors as they try to determine what needs to be done next with regards to a surgeries and those kind of things, because they were hoping to come home, get this done rather quickly, and be able to go back to Brazil. But that's not the case right now, right? We're kind of on hold. Okay, so continue to pray for them if you would. And then Isaac Gunther, Tim and Joy Gunther, missionaries that we support. Their son, he's been ill for some time. They're trying to find out what's going on with him, and they've not been able to do that. So please pray for the Gunther family if you would, please. I know that they would appreciate that. Under non-member health needs, Elaine Teichman spoke to her today as well. Lori, her daughter, as you know, battling cancer, and she was just really her kidneys were not functioning well at all. So when I talked to Elaine today, Lori was in ER and going to wait to see what happens there to get her taken care of. But please remember her in prayer if you would, please. And then Lynn Butler's brother Jerry had a setback and is back. Can you give us another update for that? No? Pardon? Okay. Okay. Multiple blood clots and just trying to get to the bottom of it. Okay. Mary Smith's brother-in-law, Don Barber, revived with CPR, but he's been able to go home now. So at least he's made some progress there. Continue to pray for him. Wanda Lee, how many of y'all know Wanda? Let me see your hand if you know Wanda Lee. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, just a handful of us. Miss Lee's been a member of the church for a long, long time. Not able to come anymore necessarily, and she fell and broke some ribs recently. So if you would do this, send her a card, would you? If you haven't done that lately, send her a card. That would be a real blessing. You say, well, I don't know her. It's okay. Tell her you're from the church, and that you love her and you pray for her anyway, even though you don't know her. And we'll meet someday, if not here in heaven, whatever. So just reach out to her if you would, please. Lori Treadwell, Julie Bacon has put this request in for some time. Lori was sent to Dallas for a surgery, came through the surgery, but they have there was no new tumors. So we praise the Lord for that. Elaine Dotson gave to us the name Matt Tharp, and Matt used to be a missionary that was out of Pleasant View, and they came home from the field, and he's now an Arlington motorcycle officer and was hit on the motorcycle the other day and is recovering from that. Do you have a further update, Elaine? Okay. 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 And then Miller Wynn's brother at MCA with blood clots as well, so we need to be praying for him. And pray for his salvation. I know Miller, I asked Miller about it the other day, and Miller said, he just says, you know, I'm going to, but he keeps pushing it off. So pray, pray for his physical health, but pray for his spiritual healing and for his salvation, that God would save him, okay? Carolyn Hancock asked that we remember her friend Jerry, Mary Jane, who's been dealing with issues, it's one of Carolyn's closest friends, got headaches and on oxygen, struggling to breathe. And then Jenny Miller's granddaughter, Kinsley, was taken to ER and then transferred to Children's Hospital in Fort Worth with just some difficulties. And then we're praying for two families that have lost loved ones. Court Stargell, his father passed away. And Court and Jennifer were here this last Sunday. We didn't get a chance to talk to them. And then Nancy Bryant's brother, you know about that. He passed away suddenly, and so we're praying for comfort for that family as, what? Okay, so pray for if you would, please, Nancy and her family. It's just very extenuating circumstances that they are dealing with, okay? Yeah, Mark, I want us to remember Carolyn, if you would, please. Carolyn, as I mentioned last week, she fell and re-injured her knee. And so we are concerned, they're concerned that maybe, I mean, hopefully not surgery again, but she's really in a lot of discomfort and a lot of pain right now. So remember her in prayer. Okay, pray for our group that's up in Branson. Get them home safely tomorrow, okay? And then just pray for our building project. God will continue to bless there. All right, let's pray. Oh, we need to have an offering, don't we? Men, let's come get ready for the offering. It's a Baptist church. What am I doing? We have a Baptist church, we've got to have an offering. We probably ought to be eating something after church. All right. Let's pray. Father, we love you. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for our time together tonight. Thank you for our business meeting. Thank you for the spirit of our church. What a blessing. We have such a spirit of cooperation and unity in what we believe you're doing. And boy, we rejoice in not only the financial blessings, but we rejoice honestly, more importantly, we rejoice in the spiritual transformation and the salvations that we've been able to see take place here recently. Young lady Angelina that was saved on Sunday, the two people that were saved the week before, the young man Caleb who came and made his profession of faith because he got saved at home Sunday morning before he came to church. We just rejoice in new people, family, new people coming into the kingdom and the family of God. And then we pray for all of the folks on our prayer list, man. We just have mentioned so many names. And then even beyond that, the list of names that are on the list, it's just overwhelming, honestly, to us, but not to you. Nothing you cannot do, nothing of which you're not aware. And so tonight, with the very best of our ability, the best we know how, we hand over, we lay these needs before you, each and every need, and ask, Lord, that you would meet those needs accordingly, according to your will, according to what you have planned. And we pray for grace and for strength for each and every situation. I pray that even right now your presence would be known right now among every name on the list, every situation, whether it's strength for a recovered surgery, whether it's comfort for the loss of a loved one, whether it's just grace to endure because of unknown diagnosis, whatever it may be. Thank you that you are God and we are not, and that you are in control. So we place every need in your hands and ask you to bless tonight. Thank you for the privilege to sing tonight, to give, to open the word, and I pray that you would speak to our hearts. Help us to be faithful to honor you in our time together in Christ's name. Amen.
Start off with Glory to His Name, and now we're going to sing His Name is Life. But first, you're going to shake hands for just about a minute and a half, and then we're going to sing through a couple of verses of this song. Let's sing together now.
His name is Master, Savior, Lion of Judah, Blessed Prince of Peace, Shepherd, Fortress, Rock of Salvation.
Bible, just pick a verse somewhere and I'll preach on it. You go ahead. Philippians chapter number 3, please. Don't hurt yourself. Philippians chapter number 3, while you're turning there, I would remind you tonight, this coming Sunday, we're looking forward to, right after the morning service, we will be having a spaghetti dinner. Spaghetti luncheon, whatever you want to call it, and hope that you will sign up for that or plan on being a part of that. And the good news is there is no set cost. You know what that means, right? Because here's what we found out. If we tell you that it's $5, you'll give us $5. If we say it's just whatever you'd like to give, we get four. No, people give more, and it's all for youth camp. It's to help the kids go to camp. We'll take our offering like we normally do in May, but Adam came in and said he wanted to do something. He wants the kids to work. And I think that's a great thing. I think, you, don't you appreciate something better or more when you work for Him? So we want our kids to put forth some effort, so we're going to be doing that on Sunday right after church. So plan on hanging around and being a part of that. Huldah, are you up there somewhere? Huldah's leaving for Egypt. When do you leave? Next Wednesday. All right. Praying for her. Another medical trip, right? Another missionary medical trip she'll be going on. So you pray for Huldah while she's away in Egypt ministering to people. You know, the last two Sundays, we've seen people come to Christ here at church. We had two people saved 2 weeks ago, a young man named Gary and then a young lady, Emily, that made her public profession of faith Sunday. And then while we were doing that, I didn't realize my wife had a young lady over here, but her name is Angelina. And she came forward, and I think Joe actually kind of said to Susan, hey, you might check on her. Susan, anyway, able to take her in the back and during the invitation and after the service, able to lead her to Christ. And 20 years of age, and just really, she said, I know what I need to do. She was very emotional, but I need to give my life to Jesus. I need to give my heart to Christ. And she did. So isn't that good? Amen. Anytime somebody gets saved, it's good. But honestly, there's nothing in the world better than that. So we are so very thankful for that. If you have not gotten your pictures done, you need to sign up. And I'll be like Lee tonight. We need to do ours. That's what he said Sunday night. I wasn't talking to his wife. I'm talking to mine, just so you'll know, okay? We haven't gotten ours done either, so we've got to get that done. Anyway, so, all right. Tonight, let's talk for a few minutes about maturity. If anybody knows anything about being mature, it's me. excuse me? I'm talking about being spiritually mature. I had a phone call, not a phone call, I had a text from a pastor friend, young man, he hasn't been pastoring a real long time, and he texted me on Monday, and he said, hey, I've got a guy in my church that he doesn't come very often, he comes maybe 5 or 6 times a year, but his son is coming to visit from California, and his son wants to be baptized, and so the dad, who comes to our church 5 or 6 times a year, has reached out to me to ask me if he could get baptized while... He didn't ask me if he could. He said, I'd like to set up baptism so my son can get baptized when he comes to the church. And he said, how would you respond to that? And I said, I wouldn't baptize him. Number two, I would explain to him the point, that one of the points of baptism is it is a public identification of your conversion to Christ and your identity with Christ, but it also is a form of entering into church membership. And so for that young man who lives in California to get baptized in your church, he would be joining your church and then going home to California. That's not a biblical process, right? Okay, now, I remember, and I explained to this young man, Aaron, a friend of mine, who grew up in the church in Graham, and I told him, I said, you know, Aaron, when I was in Graham, I said, we actually had a man that started coming to visit the church there in Graham, and he was from the Methodist church, and he started coming to our church, and he wanted to be a part of our church. He said, man, I want to be a part of this church. And so he called me, and he said, hey, I'd love to join Faith Baptist Church. He said, my deal is I've got to be baptized. I know that because I'm Methodist. I was sprinkled. He's like, but I want to get baptized on a Monday night where nobody will see me because I'm embarrassed. And so I explained to him in very sensitive, delicate terms that we can't do that. I said, no. We can't do that. I said, one of the points of baptism is for a public acknowledgement, you know, and you need to let the people know. He never came back. Now, I think the Lord honored that in my life, not in my life, but in the life of our church, because baptism is a doctrine that the Bible spells out very clearly the process. And, you know, so I try to explain that. The reason that I bring that up is because when people will ask those kind of questions, and again, I'm not beating up another denomination. I'm not saying that at all. I'm making the point about baptism because I want you to understand, want all of us to understand the value of biblical and spiritual maturity. It's so crucial that we understand that. Why is it that people do not grow spiritually? I have a few reasons. I think, let me give you these and get you to think about these for a moment. I think, first of all, we don't grow spiritually because we're creatures of habit. And old habits die hard. Anybody know that? Old habits die hard. We prefer the easy chair of comfort and familiar patterns of thinking rather than going through the process of growing spiritually and knowing how to honor the Lord, exchanging our old habits for something new that God can do. Another reason that people don't grow spiritually, and this hits pretty close to home, we want a savior, not a master. We'd rather just enjoy thinking about Jesus snatching us from the jaws of hell, if you will, and he did, and winging us to heaven, taking us to heaven, than to be confronted by those commands that are very uncomfortable for us. So we want a savior, not a master. A third reason I think we stop growing spiritually is because we stop short of our potential. I think there's more. I believe every man, woman, boy, or girl, I think God has a design for their life. You believe that? He has a purpose for your life. And I think quite often we fall short of that because of intimidation, maybe, because of we're uncomfortable, maybe we're shy. I don't know, but there's got to be something about spiritual maturity that should make us hunger. I want to know more. I want to know more. I wish I've told you before about when Susan and I, we were invited to apply as candidates for Word of Life Ministries. And we went to Scroon Lake, New York and applied, and we were up there and we had to spend 5 days in Scroon Lake, and we had to sit down with all these different people who interviewed us and all of this stuff. And I'd already graduated from Arlington Baptist College. And I remember sitting down with this guy, and he's like, Jimmy, what's your spiritual gift? You know what I said? I said, love. If you're not laughing, it's because you don't realize love is not a spiritual gift. Read Corinthians or read what Paul says about the gifts. Love is not one of them. Now, you know what that was? It wasn't ignorance. It was spiritual immaturity. I didn't know what I was talking about. Spiritual gifts. Mark, did they teach you spiritual gifts at Arlington Baptist College? Okay, he's shaking his head. No, good. Good. I didn't miss it. Okay? Spiritual. Look what Paul says in Philippians chapter number 3. And we're going to look at these verses together. Philippians chapter number 3, beginning in verse number 12. Actually, let's pick up verse 13. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended. This one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind, reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Let us therefore, as many be perfect, be thus minded, and if in anything you be otherwise minded, God shall reveal this, even this unto you. Nevertheless, whereto we've already attained, let us walk by the same rule, let us mind the same thing. Brethren, and this is a common thread in Paul's writings. Many times he will say, be followers together of me. He's very confident in his walk with the Lord and where he is spiritually. And you have to be at that place in your life to say, hey, you follow me. Follow me. Be therefore followers of me, together of me, and mark them which walk so as ye have us for an example, or example. For many walk, of whom I've told you often and now tell you even weeping, that they are the enemies. Look at this. They are the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who mind earthly things. For our conversation is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And here's why. Don't you love this verse? Yeah, I should get a loud amen out of this. Who shall change our vile body,
amen,
that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body. Man. According to the working whereby he's able even to subdue all things unto himself. Throughout these verses, Paul gives to us, if you will, he gives us some things to shoot for, if I can say it that way, to some principles to understand and to desire to attain. When the goal is spiritual maturity, here's what Paul says. We need to realize some things. And here's what he says in verse number 12 and 13. He says, and I'll give you these five things real quick. Here we go. Number one, the plan is progress, not perfection. The plan is progress, not perfection. He says in verse 12, not that as though I've already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. You know what he's saying? He's like, now if we would say to about any writer of the Word of God, Paul would be probably first on the list if we would say, here's a guy who is spiritually mature. Here's a guy, if anyone has arrived, it's the Apostle Paul. And yet Paul says, I'm not there. I've not attained. I haven't arrived. And then he makes it, and it's not like he's saying, guys, man, I've just really blown it. Because just a few verses later, he says, follow me. So that tells us, the plan is progress, not perfection. If you think that you have to be perfect in order for God to use you, you're in trouble. Because you're not ever in this life going to be perfect. But there is a progress in our spiritual maturity that should be happening. In verse 13, I count not myself to have apprehended. What is he saying there? I have not arrived. He says, I haven't gotten there. Not one admission, but two admissions. Two things he mentions about his own imperfection. And he says, I'm not there. He says, I am a work in progress. What's the song say? He's still working on me. Right, yeah. To make me what I ought to be. How many of you have arrived? You are where? You've reached your destination. You don't need to go any further. Anybody? What? It's the only reason nobody raised your hand because all the men are over there, right? Not all the men. Sorry. You're right. I'm sorry. Sorry, guys. That didn't sound nice. The plan is progress, not perfection. Are you, look, everybody look right here at me because I can't see you. Are you making progress? Are you closer to the Lord? Are you more like Jesus Christ now than you were January the 1st? Or September of last year? Are you more of a godly mother now than you were 4 months ago? Are you more of a godly employee? Are you more of a godly, this sounds weird, a godly Christian? Because we got a lot of ungodly Christians in the world. Are you more of a godly, are you making progress? That's the goal, making progress. We're not going to arrive in this life, but we've got something to shoot for. So we need to do that. Here's the second thing he tells us. If we're gonna grow into spiritual maturity, here's the second thing. The past is over. Forget it. The plan is progress, not perfection. Number two, the past is over. Forget it. He says in verse number 13, this one thing I do. What? Forgetting those things which are behind. Everybody in this room, everyone in this room has at least one thing that you can't forget. probably one time when you blew it in a greater way than you ever have, or you chose the wrong thing, you made the wrong decision, you went the wrong direction, or there's just something, I just can't get over it. And the Apostle Paul says, we need to realize, is that if we're going to hang in there for the long haul, if we're going to see ourselves grow, I'm amazed at how David came to understand the grace of God after everything he did. I'm amazed that, and again, man, you go back and think about the life of Peter, and I'll never deny you. Liar, liar, right? Because he did. And how that God showed up and Jesus showed back up on the beach, fixes breakfast for them, confronts Peter, even the angel, when he said to the women, go and tell the disciples, and what? And Peter calls him by name. Isn't it great to hear God call your name? Calls him by name. Says, go tell the disciples and Peter that Jesus is alive, and I'll meet them. He will meet with them. I'm just simply saying here, he says, you got to forget the past. If we're to press forward, if we're to move forward, we cannot focus on yesterday. Can't do that. Number three, he says, the future holds out hope. Reach for it. Again, in verse number 13, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before me. I don't know if Paul had the Olympics in mind, the chariots in mind when he mentions this, reaching forth to those things which are still ahead, which are before, to those things which lie ahead. But in ancient Greece, they had great Olympic chariot races. Maybe that's what he's talking about. Maybe he's thinking about standing on a small platform, leaning forward, and those people who they're straining their muscles to keep their balance and to control those horses. And in doing so, he stretches himself as he drove hard to win. In the same way, listen, when God sends a trial in our lives, it is to stretch us. To stretch us. For what purpose? Huh? To grow, to help us grow. Remember the time that I was preaching on God stretching us, and I asked if anybody had stretch marks? We had one lady raise her hand. I'm like, I don't want to know that. Don't tell me that. Spiritually speaking, that's terrible. That's one of those things, Joe. He said, have you ever said something and you go, oh, why in the world? I said, all the time. Why did I say that? He said, it used to happen to him a lot too. It happened to me when I said, how many of you have stretch marks? That happened. But spiritually speaking, we should have stretch marks. Hello? Do you have any? Yeah, you know when you have a stretch mark? When the doctor says it's cancer. When the kid runs away from home. When the boss calls you in with a pink slip. When the bottom falls out. Sometimes it's just temptation in your life. God sees these things coming and allows them to serve as opportunities for us to either grow or crash and burn. And those stretch marks help us grow spiritually and make us stronger for the next time. The future holds out hope. Reach for it. Number four, he says, the secret is a determined attitude. Maintain that. He says, the verse 14, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Let us therefore, as many as be perfect, be thus minded. He's talking about being complete in the Lord. Our salvation is secure. It is complete. And as a result of that, we should be thus minded. If in anything ye be otherwise minded, God shall reveal this even unto you. He's simply saying here, look, it's very important that you understand that God is going somewhere, that God is doing something, and you need to be pressing for the prize, pressing for the mark, for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Here's what he's doing. He's giving us the liberty to go at our own pace, but to be going. If you're not going, you're not growing. If you're not moving forward in your walk, in fact, I've heard it said and believe it's probably true. If you're not moving forward, you're backing up, you're backsliding. Good thought. Thank you. Let me give you the fifth thing, number five, because I have a few more points after these five. Number five, the need is to keep a high standard, and that high standard is togetherness. He says in verse 16, nevertheless, whereto we have already attained, let us walk by the same rule. Let us mind the same thing. Notice how Paul, he shifts from the focus of himself, from saying, I press on, to all believers, and now he's saying, let all of us, hey, we're in this together. You know what? It really matters to me. It really matters to me what happens to Carol. You know why? Because Carol is my sister. Not only that, but I'm the under shepherd. She's one of our sheep. It really matters what happens in Susan's life. It matters to me what happens in your life. Now, watch this. Marcia, it should matter to you what happens in Betty's life, because nobody else cares what happens in Betty's life. It should matter. Betty, I'm just kidding. You know I love you. What happens in Mary's life? Here she's going through a deal with her brother right now. That should matter to you. Right? We're in this together. And what happens to, listen, when I was pastoring in one of my former churches, we had a guy that was sexually abusing his daughter. And he was in a high profile position in the city. And I called him in one day and I said, you and your family need to leave our church. And I said, why? And I said, this is why. Because you're not sorry for your sin. You are sorry you got caught. And God's going to expose you. And I said, and when he does, you're not going to take this church's reputation with you. He said, where are we going to go? And I said, you know, with all due respect, that's not my deal. As the old saying goes, you made your bed, you're going to lie in it. And so they left, and it wasn't 30 days later, the police showed up at his place of business and arrested him. And I'm just like, man, listen, we're in this together. My job as the under shepherd is to do the best I can to protect the flock, to protect the church. And sometimes, you know, sometimes the Bible says, here's what the Bible, it's not Jimmy talking, it's God talking. There will always be goats among the sheep. That's bad news. That was bad, I know. There will always be goats among the sheep. If you know of a goat in our church, let me know. Because our job is togetherness. Amen? Amen? And everybody needs to be on the same page. Here's a news flash. I'm going to just put you at ease right now. Eventually, if it hasn't happened yet, I'm going to do something to make you mad. Some of you say, it didn't take but about a week for me when you got here. I get that. Somebody here is going to do something else to make one of you mad or to offend you. It's my spiritual gift, unfortunately, to say something that offends people. I'm you know my problem, okay? And I'm working on it. But we're in this together. And if we don't look out for one another, who will? Because I'm telling you, there might be goats in the church, but the wolf is at the door, just waiting for the opportunity to attack. And we got to look out for each other. So this idea of togetherness is important. So here's what we do. He closes in my mind at 17 through 21. I'm just going to throw these at you real quick. He basically gives us four reminders. He says, first of all, in verse 17, we need examples to follow. We need examples to follow. Number two, we live among many who are enemies of the cross. I just mentioned that. There are a lot, and that's in verses 18 and 19. He talks about that, man. There are many who walk that they are enemies of the cross of Christ. We live among many who are the enemies. Number three, here's the good news, verse 20 and 21. We belong to those who are bound for heaven. We belong to those. What does he say in verse number 20? For our conversation, that refers to our citizenship. For our citizenship is where? Everybody say where? He says it's in heaven. I thought I was part of the United States. Earthly speaking, you are, but eternally speaking, we're part of the kingdom of heaven. We're citizens there. So we need to know that. We need to know who we are. And then the last thing he says here, these four points, in chapter 4, verse number 1, therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved, and long for my joy and crown, so stand fast in the Lord, my dearly beloved. Here's what I believe he's saying there in chapter 4, verse 1. This is the fourth thing. We must stand firm, but not stand still. We must stand firm, but not stand still. Let me make this announcement. If you're not doing anything for Jesus Christ, you're not doing anything of value. Is that one of those comments I shouldn't make? If we're not doing anything for Him, then anything else that we're doing really doesn't matter. That's really the point I'm trying to make. Listen, we need spiritual maturity. And the people, this last Sunday morning, we had 450 people in the sanctuary. We had 450 people. I don't know how many we have in here tonight. We have 81 in here right now. Now, there are people all over the campus tonight. But we have 450 people here Sunday morning. Many of those people are not spiritually mature. And it's a really difficult thing as a pastor and as a preacher of the gospel, a preacher of the Word of God, to try to draw in somebody who's very, very surface level, maybe a new Christian, and also try to throw enough meat out there where Ron can handle it. I just got both of y'all at the same time, both Rons. Where Larry, who served as a missionary for 100 years, I mean, what in the world can I teach him? To be able to try to do that is so difficult. It's so difficult. Sunday, I preached that whole message from the book of Joshua, never mentioned the gospel until the end during the invitation, shared the gospel, and Angelina comes down and Susan's able to lead her to Christ. You know what that is? That's God blessing the preaching of His word.
Amen.
That had nothing to do with this guy standing behind the pulpit. It had everything to do with him.
Amen.
And God blessing what Pleasant View is doing. Let's make sure we maintain that unity together and that we move on to maturity. Let me ask you to bow your heads, please, for just a moment. Paul says in this passage that our focus is to be on the Lord. He's our confidence. He's our joy. He's our strength. He gives us the ability to stand firm. I plead with you as your pastor. I plead with you keep going and keep growing. Keep growing. Defend one another as long as we are not compromising Scripture. Love one another, support one another, and grow in your walk with the Lord. With your heads bowed tonight, maybe tonight you just need to make that commitment. Maybe there's somebody in the church that you are not particularly fond of. Maybe they've offended you. The best thing in the world that you can do to that person is get on your knees and pray for them. That's the greatest thing you can do. Let's commit ourselves tonight to unity, to spiritual maturity, to walking for the Lord, walking with the Lord, so that the enemies of the cross of Christ can see the love of Jesus flowing through us. Lord, we love you tonight. We thank you for loving us and thank you for our time together. And just a pretty basic, simple Bible study tonight, but man, just so full of truth and encouragement and conviction. And I pray tonight that as we leave here, we will have a little more truth than we had before we got here. I pray tonight we'll leave here with repentance in our heart because of conviction. I pray tonight we'll leave here encouraged and have a desire to want to grow more and more in our faith and our walk with you. I pray tonight you'll keep the wolf outside, the wolves outside. I pray that you'll remove the goats, if you will. And Lord, that we'll be able to have unity in our midst, because all we like sheep have gone astray. And by the grace of God, we're here together trying to just continue to do a work that was laid out for this church 78 years ago. And we're just trying to keep the flame burning. Help us to do that well. Protect us and dismiss us as we go home tonight. Bring us back together at the appointed time. Prepare our hearts even now for what you're going to do in us, through us, around us on Sunday. Help us to come to the Lord's house, not only ready to worship, but ready to worship not only in song, but in our hearing, in our teaching, and in what you have already in store for us. We love you tonight. Thank you for loving us in Christ's name. Amen. All right. Well, thank you for being here tonight. And let's stand, if you would please, and go home. You're dismissed. Thank you.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. With a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, his love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever.
Sing praise. Was rich, I remember who I was. I was lost, I was blind, I was running out of time. Sin separated, the breach was far too wide. But from the far side of the chasm, you held me in your sight. So you made a way across the great divide. Left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross you paid the debt I owe. Broke my chains, freed my soul. For the first time I at home. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life. Brought me from the darkness into glorious life. You took my place, laid inside my tomb of sin. You were buried for 3 days, but then you walked right out again. And now death has no sting. No end. For I have been transformed by the blood of the Lamb. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood of life. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood of life.
brought me from the darkness into glorious light. Glory to His name.
Desert place, though I walk through the wilderness.